This video was made possible through the support of my patrons.
The most precious thing on this earth is the human brain, and yet we allow it to die.
It is quite useless to resist, as we are stronger and more efficient than your Earth people.
You belong to us. You shall be like us.
The ascension shall begin.
The strength and might of the cyber race will be confirmed.
Pay. I am Vanguard. Pain.
Cybercember has reached the 21st century, the year is 2001, and Doctor Who hasn't entered production on UK TV for 12 years. The 30th anniversary Dimensions in Time was a flop, the TV movie wasn't the hit overseas that Fox needed it to be, and while Big Finish were starting to find niche success with their audio productions starring classic Doctors, the book had effectively been closed on Doctor Who ever making it back to British TV. However, with the advent of the internet allowing for online webcast stories as well as rumours circulating of a Doctor Who animated series being produced from Canada, in fact we even have access to old concept art of this proposed idea, the BBC decided to finally end the story of the Doctor by commissioning a low-budget, partially animated webcast called Doctor Who Death Comes to Time, which starred Sylvester McCoy as the Seventh Doctor, Sophie Aldred as Ace, and Nicholas Courtney as the Brigadier, which ended with the Doctor sacrificing himself to save Gallifrey and the rest of the universe, though his body is never found. It's a five-part story, you can watch it online, but that's not what we're here to talk about today, because after the moderate success of Death Comes to Time, the BBC commissioned more webcasts with alternate Doctors. We got an adaptation of the lost story Shadow by Douglas Adams, starring Paul McGann as the Eighth Doctor, as well as today's feature presentation, 2002's Real Time, a co-production from the BBC and Big Finish Productions, starring Colin Baker, once again returning to face the Cybermen.
Even more of me. You're wasting your time. I've locked all the doors.
Due to the limited bandwidth of early 2000s internet, it and other webcasts were mainly comprised of still artwork from artist Lee Sullivan and had to be restricted in terms of length. It could only be 60 minutes long. So writer and executive producer for Big Finish, Gary Russell, decided to have fun with the concept and make Real Time comprise of 6 10-minute episodes, which took place in real time. And because of Big Finish's involvement, we have the addition of audio-only Sixth Doctor companion Evelyn Smythe, played by Maggie Stables. Also, crash course on Evelyn Smythe, history teacher from the present day, keeps the Sixth Doctor in check, loves chocolate, is amazing. I've not listened to many Evelyn stories at the time of writing this, but I love her already. She's already my favourite Sixth Doctor companion. Anyway, let's talk about real time. So, we're on a desert planet in the 33rd century, and the Sixth Doctor and Evelyn have been asked to assist a survey team to determine what has happened to their two prior research groups who disappeared on the planet, with two groups going missing at the exact same time on two consecutive days. It doesn't take long for the Doctor to discover that the cause of the disappearance is a time portal at the centre of a pyramid, a portal that is currently under the control of a cyber controller from the far future, who is hoping to utilise it to prevent all future defeats in the upcoming cyber wars. It's up to the Doctor to stop the cyber leader from meddling with the web of time, and to make sure him and his friends don't wind up converted into Cybermen. So what I've just described there isn't just a synopsis and sales pitch for real time. It is real time. As in, it's all set up, it's all talk, it's all prologue. Because real time ends on a cliffhanger without a resolution, but more on that later. It's all about moving the chess pieces in place and catching the audience up to speed on what happened before the episode that led up to these events, like the history of the Cybermen, how the Cyber Controller got where he is in the first place, what's the deal with Professor Goddard, voiced by Yi Ji So, who you may remember as Chang Li from the TV movie. Real time isn't so much a story as it is a vehicle for exposition. It feels like every 10 minutes minutes, there's a lengthy spiel about what's happening and what's going on, and to be honest, it's not very engaging, and I found real time to be a bit of a chore to watch. Now, before you say anything and assume, this is not to do with the static nature of the animation or audio productions. I enjoy watching motion comics, and while I've not listened to that many, relatively speaking, I have really enjoyed The Sixth Doctor and Evelyn Big Finish Adventures. I also understand that the context in 2002 is massively different to 2020. Back then, the show was presumed dead, so maybe fans embraced this wholeheartedly, whereas now we're kind of inundated with Doctor Who media, so this webcast isn't that novel. In fact, please let me know what you think of real time down below. I genuinely have no idea what the consensus of this story is, and what fans generally think of it. I am going to be relying on you folks for this one. All I know for certain is that, for me, real time was a slog. The exposition is only in service of an off-screen lore that I'd much rather be watching a story about that, as opposed to just watching this cast of really bland supporting characters just standing around waiting for the hour to expire. You see, the real time aspect of this story is that the temporal disturbance caused by the time portal is just under an hour away, so this hour-long story is the lead-up to that happening again. This literally results in a plot where the characters are just standing around, waiting for the interesting stuff to happen. Real time is only an hour long, but it felt like I'd stepped into a time portal to watch it, as it felt like an eternity. Now, the supporting cast are just bland vectors for dialogue and just waiting to be partially converted by the cyber controller. They're partially converted because the controller is low on power and resources, but thankfully, the Sixth Doctor and Evelyn come out of this story looking pretty good. The Sixth Doctor, wearing a new blue outfit, which goes completely unexplained, is more akin to his Big Finish persona as being a bit more down-to-earth and kinder. It's a great mix of the TV version and the Big Finish version, where the Sixth Doctor can try and bluff the cyber men into killing their hostages.
You will come with us. Take the others away.
Yes, Commander.
I say again, why?
You will come with us.
Why? Tell me why I should.
Careful, Doctor.
If you do not, the hostages will be killed.
So? Well, that's hardly a threat. If I refuse to budge, a handful of lives gone. If I go with you and give you the secrets of my TARDIS, that's eternity gone. Not really a contest, is it?
Thanks. He has a point.
Doctor, these four humans are your friends. Their deaths can be slow and painful.
So that's it. Come with us or we hurt your friends. No. My friends mean a great deal to me, but they're still expendable when put against the fate of the universe. You won't get what you want by killing anyone.
You have 3 minutes to decide.
Will you really sacrifice us, Doctor?
If he has to, yes.
Evelyn, you know me too well.
But we do get the best of both worlds with a wonderfully empathetic Doctor who gives the definitive mic drop on why the Doctor is the perfect adversary to contrast against the Cybermen.
Evelyn Smythe has provided our controller with an ability to bargain with you. That opportunity was not present before her capture. You are now in an inferior position.
Well, against Cybermen, I'm always in an inferior position if we're talking about might. But I'm talking about life. And my feelings, my love for Evelyn, can never make me inferior. I beg you to stop if you threatened her, or any of these people, in fact. And you see that as weakness. But in proving that, you've given both myself and Evelyn a greater strength. Because neither she nor I will devalue our friendship no matter what the cost. Something you see no value in, and that is my advantage.
Although, while I do say the Sixth Doctor comes out of this story looking good, there are a few unflattering angles of the Sixth Doctor in this story. Like come on, that just looks mean. We also have Evelyn, and because she's basically unlike any companion in the show's history except maybe Barbara, she infuses every story she's in with a unique perspective. She's old and modest enough to know her worth in certain situations, but she's well-travelled enough to not take anyone's shit, which is why she's able to work as such an effective anchor for the Sixth Doctor. She seems simultaneously world-weary and full of life, and because she's unwilling to just take things at face face value and find the grey areas of history, it's always fascinating when she comes across such binary evil threats, such as the Daleks and the Cybermen, with her questioning of the Cyber Controller reading as a prelude to her empathy towards the lone Dalek in the Big Finish story Jubilee, which came out a year or two after Real Time. And that affect would later be translated to Rose Tyler when Jubilee was heavily adapted to the screen.
Who were you? What did you do?
You?
Yes, you. You must have had dreams once. You must have lived, loved, and had a belief in something. A purpose.
Dreams are unimportant to the cyber race. Belief is unimportant. Power is all.
Yes, but I noticed something.
What?
That dreams weren't unimportant. They were something you understand. You remember. Who were you? See if you can dig back through your database and discover your name.
Name? I have had no name. My role, my purpose is to seed the universe with Cybermen. The cyber race will destroy all those who do not succumb to conversion. That is all.
Oh. Yes. I see. Thank you. By the way, who are you so desperate to convince? Me? Or yourself?
Evelyn is an experienced history teacher. From her students, she has heard every argumentative tactic in the book and has an insane capacity to read a room and has no filter. Evelyn is awesome. As for the Cybermen, I think this is where the limited nature of the webcast clashes with the story itself, because we're told through dialogue that these Cybermen are partially converted and malformed, but the artwork just doesn't really go far enough to reflect this. There's a tuft of hair on the forehead and some pink shading underneath the helmet, but that seems to be about as far as it goes. Now, in terms of the story, we have Nicholas Briggs voicing the excellent shouting cyber controller, and it's interesting to see the Cybermen try to manipulate the research team into trying to gain access to the Doctor's TARDIS. Like when the Cyberman, formerly Nicola Savage, appears to be breaking through her cyber conditioning and is begging the Doctor for help, but the Doctor knows it's a trick and that he's being manipulated. That's such a great subversion of the trope and demonstrates that there really is no turning back after a conversion. Speaking of conversion, I was kind of taken aback at how brutal the conversion process was in this animated story. There's blood, the sound of tearing and soaring into flesh, it's a lot. And we also have this sequence where a Cyberman is torturing Renchard for information and crushes his head so hard that it explodes into a bloody mess. And this isn't just a quick act of violence, this scene goes on for an entire minute. I said in my review of Attack of the Cybermen that the hand-crushing scene is the most violent thing I'd seen in the show, but to clarify, I'm strictly talking about the TV show. There's obviously been more violent things in Torchwood or the Virgin New Adventure novels, the latter of which seems to be more in line with the violence on display in real time. Unfortunately, it just stems back to the bland characters. I don't care about these people getting converted. I didn't even know the name of the guy who got his head crushed, despite that taking place in Act 3 of the story, and I had plenty of time to get to know him, but I had no idea who they were. Real Time didn't even attempt to give them defined personalities. It's far more interested in just bombarding you with exposition, with monologues, with wibbly-wobbly timey-wimey stuff. These aren't scenes, these aren't character beats. They're back-to-back exposition dumps, and they're not in aid of the current events of the story, because there isn't a story being told. It's all set up for a sequel which we never got. So let's talk about that. Okay, so spoilers for the ending of Real Time in case you wanted to watch it for yourself first. Spoilers in 3, 2, 1. Okay, so the Cyber Controller's plan is to convert Evelyn Smythe into a brand new controller. This plan is in response to Goddard revealing himself to be a cybernetic creature, which was the end result of the Cybermen releasing a virus on an alternative version of Earth in the early 20th century. This also makes him invisible to Cybermen, which is why, in the clip I played earlier, the Cyberman said that the Doctor had four human friends despite there being five people on screen. Anyway, Goddard somehow got sent to the 33rd century with a virus that can destroy the Cybermen, but the Controller reverse engineers it, creating the original virus in the first place. We effectively have a grandfather paradox. As the Doctor rescues Evelyn from being converted, Goddard kills the Controller and takes off the faceplate to reveal that the Controller was Evelyn Smythe. This Controller had been a converted Evelyn all along, and the one in the present with the Doctor was partially converted before she got rescued and is in possession of the virus, with the cliffhanger being that Evelyn convinces the Doctor to go back to the early 20th century where Goddard originally came from, presumably to release the virus on humanity in the first place. Now this is a pretty awesome cliffhanger. It's not good enough to justify the slog that leads up to it, but it is interesting, and a sequel to Real Time was on the cards to depict the rest of the story, but it never came to be. See, after this story and the release of the webcast adaptation of Shudder, the BBC decided to change tactics and make their next production in-house. This eventually became The Scream of the Shouker, starring Richard E. Grant as the Ninth Doctor. This seemingly unprovoked abandoning of Big Finish's involvement in the webcasts resulted in a falling out between the two parties, and this cliffhanger was never resolved, and Gary Russell himself considers Real Time to be not canon in the Big Finish universe. And that's kind of insane. Big Finish, which embellishes every single corner of the Doctor Who universe, has deemed this to be the thing that is not canon. It's a bit of a shame though, because the only reason to really bother watching Real Time is so you can be prepared with all of the info for its follow-up, which never transpired. However, there is a brief reference to a Sixth Doctor and partially converted Evelyn in the novel Spiral Scratch, also written by Gary Russell, which features multiple Sixth Doctors from alternative realities.
Even more of me!
To wrap up though, I would only really recommend Real Time for completionists or as a curiosity, because it doesn't really work as a standalone story, because it's just too dense and bogged down with setup and Wikipedia articles worth of backstory. The Sixth Doctor and Evelyn are great, but that's kind of the beginning and the end of my positive feelings for Real Time. Okay, so before we get back to the main Doctor Who universe, let's spend a bit more time in the wilderness. How about some proper Big Finish next time? Let's find a Big Finish Cyberman story. Oh boy, oh wow, so many to choose from. Okay, oh, I know, let's spin a wheel and find out where we land. Well, okay then.